IVM. Welcome to today's episode of This Round Is On Me. The last month or so has been the most tragic for India, probably the worst since partition. The global news covered the dire state of affairs, with people struggling to stay alive for lack of oxygen, hospital beds, medication, vaccines, and more. Our official death and infection rates are in no way a reflection of the reality on the ground. You get the drift. My guests today, two industry colleagues, chefs who have gone well beyond the call of duty to extend their platform and efforts towards COVID relief. Chef Saransh Goila and Nisa Mendes, welcome to the show and thank you for making the time.
Thank you.
Thank you, Gauri. Thank you for having us over.
So, Saransh, I'm going to start with you. How did you get the idea of COVID Meals for India and, you know, how did the initiative begin? Can you sort of take us through that?
Gauri, it was a very, very simple thought, which, you know, practically, literally came walking to me because I got a lot of direct messages on Instagram of people asking for help in a unique situation which was created by this second wave of the pandemic, which meant that people were falling ill in clusters, specifically in the entire pin code. Maybe everybody in your building is sick if you're living in a society, or the restrictions are so tight that your own friends and family could not help you. If you were somebody who had COVID and you were restricted or confined in isolation in your own home. So there seemed to be a large need for people who were looking for home-cooked meals while they were in isolation. You know, and there were unique cases like grandparents who can't cook for themselves, or young kids who got stuck alone because maybe somebody got admitted to the hospital. And in this case, your neighbor can't help you, your closest relatives can't help you, and hence there was a need to just connect the dots. That's how COVID Meals for India started. It started as a Google spreadsheet where I started collecting home chefs or volunteers pan India who were willing to help people with home cooked meals, whether it was one meal or two meals or 100 meals. There was no sort of barrier to entry. Once I started to assemble this list, it caught up very, very quickly, and it was a sign that there were many cases in the country and COVID Meals for India was needed by a certain section of patients who were isolating at home. And that's where it sort of fit in. Within a week's time, from like 200 volunteers / home cooks, the list grew to about 2,000. And currently we're at about 5,000 people who are 5,000 volunteers / home chefs who are providing their services across India.
So it's still being utilized, you feel?
It's dropped down drastically. In the first week, we saw about 1.5 lakh people who accessed the website. Currently, on a week-on-week basis, is about 20,000 people who are accessing the website. So it's really gone down.
And how many cities were you able to kind of get, sort of find volunteers in?
About 410 cities is the last that I checked. Basically, because as I said, it was just a connecting tool. We asked people to register through a WhatsApp registration verification process where they had to just fill up a form as to what kind of meals they're providing, what kind of hours they're operational. It's typically like a restaurant style listing that you know, we would do on any delivery platform, or as a organization, we would sign on to a website. So it was a very basic form that they had to fill, and they were live on COVID Meals for India.
But how were you able to verify, especially when people were like all over the country, how were you able to actually verify that these people are legitimate sort of providers of food, etc.?
So after their WhatsApp verification, which would give us, we've also partnered with Facebook and WhatsApp in this process, which meant that any WhatsApp number that was getting verified, we also had verified that we were able to figure that the person is verified, which means it's not a number that somebody is randomly using. And then we had put some volunteers to make phone calls and check, just do proof check. There is no other way, unfortunately, because no one can reach 400 cities. And we are also working on sort of the goodwill of people, and we are hoping. But of course, there is always that one odd case that comes up in a case like this. We had one or two people who had signed on to the platform, who committed to sending meals, and then they disappeared. after taking orders, etc.
But so, of course, like you said, I mean, you know, like one or two in sort of where you've got thousands of people is something that you just have to live with and look at the bigger picture here. Yeah,
my team, because we tried figuring this one out where the biggest challenge here is you're feeding food to a patient. And the onus of that can only be on the person who's actually feeding him or her, right? And hence, we were directly connecting the patients to the home chefs, where we were not fulfilling orders as a website. We were just connecting the dots. And we were very thorough in that, where we would send a WhatsApp message to anybody using the platform saying that do a background check on the person you're ordering from. It's very, very important. And mostly, we have not seen that kind of issue where somebody has probably tweeted to me or said, you know what, we received food from this place and it was not good. Mm. Or, you know, what have they sent to us? I also feel people are less choosy and they are just okay and happy receiving a meal that is home cooked. So yeah. we didn't see any of those challenges, and I'm glad for that.
That's amazing. And, you know, I mean, you mentioned about how people are probably like, you know, people using the service were those living alone or just didn't, you know, isolated, etc. I have to tell you, luckily she didn't turn out to be positive, but our cook at home, you know, started sort of complaining of symptoms. And by the time we could get someone to test her and wait for the result, like we obviously quarantined her just to be on the safe side. And I was actually alone with her in our home in Alibag with my daughter. And I don't know if you know this about me, but I cannot cook to save my life. Like literally, I'm
aware.
And I was really put to the test with that one. So, you know, I mean, I would have jumped at something like this. I mean, of course, there was access to food, but I can understand. And the first thing that came to me was that, you know, what do I give her? Because she's finding, you know, food sort of lost her sense of taste. And, you know, what do I kind of even give her? And it really is something that, you know, any kind of support that you can get, where even someone that you feel has it together and, you know, is sensible and all of that, you really feel quite helpless when you're actually in that situation. So, I mean, this is incredible what you've created here. And I'm going to come back to you, obviously, and sort of ask you more about this. But Nisa, tell us, you know, you started this initiative called Bake for India. And I know that we at Max Street Bread Co. participated in that. And, you know, it was sort of really amazing what you've done. So can you tell us a little bit about how that happened and, you know, what the initiative was exactly?
Yeah, for sure. I think that largely a lot of it just happened again organically. For me personally, I think what happened was that, like you said, right, it was so overwhelming right in the beginning. And for me, I just actually got really angry. I think that was the predominant feeling. I was just so angry at everything and at how collectively the system had allowed it, the governments had allowed it to reach this stage. And it didn't feel like it also just didn't feel like enough was being done, right? And we were all like grasping at that time. And I find it, I think it was also actually much easier to channel anger into action than it is to channel despair into action. Like, I was so angry that I was like, okay, you know what? I need to do something. Because for me, I know that last lockdown, I had some sort of vague idea about it as well earlier, but it felt very overwhelming at that time. And this time I said, I'm not going to overthink it. I'm just going to do. So while I knew that if I did start, I could perhaps extend it. And even when I first posted, I extended it out to other people. I didn't want to work on that first and then, you know, set up a system. I just said, I'm going to start and take it as it comes. And that's really what happened. So I didn't even have it named. Like, I didn't have the hashtag, didn't have anything when I started. I was like, I'm going to do this. I'm going to bake my own tarts and I'm going to sell them. And, you know, if anybody else wants help. And at that point, I had so much energy that I needed to like channel. I was like, okay, if you need help also organizing your own bake sale, but hey, also I have a lot of communications and like marketing experience. If you're a brand and you want to sit with me on a Zoom call and chat about like what you can do, I'll do that. I'm happy to like help do anything. And I think within under an hour, like, I think mine sold out, you know, it was, and the amount of people that shared it, like a couple hundred people shared it, I think even that first initial go, right? So there was a lot of like immediate energy. Within a couple of hours, there's a Fat Cats Cafe, which did your Melanie from Fat Cats Cafe, which they did, I think, Gauri, they did Max Street bake sale. And so I was happy to help with absolutely like anything at that point. And I know that as soon as I like posted, about it. Like, I think I had said this, I'm not sure, but I'll just recap. So as soon as I posted, my personal one sold out in under the hour. It was not many. But what was really amazing was that a lot of people shared it. So I feel like that, you know, initial momentum helped build. And there was Melanie from Fat Cats Cafe, who also does like the Mac Street.
Yeah.
So she, within a couple of hours, she DM'd me. She's like, hey, can I do this exact same thing? Can I replicate it? And I was like, yes, of course you can, because that's what I've said. Please go ahead. So she posted. So she had her own like bake sale going within a couple of hours. In that first like few days, maybe about 10 or 12 people emailed me in those first few hours. And I was like, okay, now I need to structure this.
Right.
So now I need to like figure it out, structure it, do it. So I took maybe about a day, put down all the pointers, put down like a format. This friend of mine, Padma, reminded me, thank God, like start a Google form, don't collect stuff on email, because I'm really bad at this like tech sorting out. Okay, I'm like, oh, email me all this information. And she's like, no. And that really helped. So, you know, just like really basic things, but I'm a bit pedantic. So like it was this 12-point email. It was like, there was lots of like information. Then we named it and decided to keep it a little bit like wider. So like we called it Bake for India. And I posted that and I was like, share.
Yeah.
And that moved really fast. I think I got maybe about 100 emails in the first like a day or two, with just people wanting to participate and, you know, wanting to do things. I think that what helped a lot was that there were just largely three things that you had to follow. You had to like be willing to like bake or share, bake like 10 things, and you had to donate all proceeds, and you had to donate all proceeds and 10 things. And but, you know, so it was fairly simple. And I think that what helped was that it was not overwhelming. So it was easy for most, you know, for a lot of people, like Sanj and I were discussing, for like other people to
I mean, I have to tell you, and so like I mentioned, I'm actually in Alibag, and Janki Thakase, who's here and is one of the most amazing Flower Girl Bombay, as she's known on Instagram, and she's one of the most incredible bakers, and she reached out and she was like, you know, I'm thinking of doing this, but then I've like decided that it's actually going to be a bit of a nightmare, because, you know, I want to do it in Bombay, but I'm based now in Alibag and stuff. And I just told her, I said that, you know, we have our delivery guys coming to Alibag every single day. I said, they go back empty handed, let them take it. And we'll just charge a small delivery fee for like them having to zip around the city and just to cover their cost of delivery. And, we'll do it. And
helped a lot.
It was so cool. And I was just like, first of all, I like live on her cookies. So I was just like, you know, spread the love. But then, and she did it in Alibag as well. And
she went from wanting to do 10,000, like to raise 10,000. She raised 50 over those 2 days.
Yeah.
And you know, I found that happened a lot. Like it happened with me as well, right? I said, I'll do 10. And then I ended up doing 12. And then I stopped. But most people did more than they wanted to do.
I know. And
sort of get caught up in it.
When we reached out, we were like, oh, let's do this over a week and we'll pick something.
Yeah.
And you were like, guys, just keep it simple. Let's keep the same thing. And that's the thing that, you know, I think you really hit the nail on the head with the fact that there are two things here. One is that I have to tell you, I had a kind of reverse experience to you guys, or at least Nisa, what you mentioned, where last year you felt overwhelmed, but then this year you were like, you know, I'm going to do something. For me, it was actually the flip. The way it all happened was last year, I just felt for some reason, and maybe because I was in the kitchen every day because we were so short-staffed, and we started this Feed the Needy program with NRAI to help with, you know, feeding the migrant workers.
Yeah.
And we were able to do that. And I think we were just in the kitchen and, you know, we were able to mobilize food faster and it all worked out. This year, on the other hand, I actually felt more paralyzed. I was just, you know, and I was like, what do I do? I really want to do something. But this time the lockdown just felt, you know, it just felt like a bigger, like, you know, bam on us, because we had a bigger team this time round. And, you know, it was just a lot more overwhelming with everything going on. And of course, the news hitting you like every day, like, you know, really like kind of a slap in the face every single day. And So it just, you know, it became, and then when you presented this, like you said, it was simple, it was small, it was achievable. You know, it's like those smart goals that you set for yourself, but it was literally that. And I think that's what just people like, oh, we can help in some way. Let's get going, you know? And I think that move, like just moving from that inertia of like not being able to do something and start kind of like, you know, made you feel like, okay, I can actually do this. And, you know, and I really think that that's what happened, which was amazing. But
I also think it was somebody giving you like the idea. I think I was also very clear with the structure.
Yeah.
And I really think what really helped it was that was collective action.
Yeah.
That so many of us were doing it together that it was so motivating for everybody together, you know?
And also, you know, just for everyone listening who wasn't aware of the initiative, you also left it open to every baker or organization to decide whom they wanted to support. So, you know, you were not saying that, okay, everything has to go to this one entity or whatever. It was like, you know, whoever you want to support and, you know, that's entirely up to you. So we ended up actually supporting an organization called the Railway Children. Yeah. And I'm going to kind of come back to this point a little later as to, you know, how do you pick one cause, right? That's just so hard. But just coming back to both these initiatives, COVID Meals for India as well as Bake for India, what I thought was really interesting was that both of y'all were kind of like intermediaries, right? So you triggered something. It wasn't like you were like, okay, I'm cooking like, you know, 10,000 meals a day or I'm baking 10,000 tarts a day. It was just like, hey, I'm, you know, going to use my sort of platform, or I'm going to use my, you know, just be a resource pool. And I felt like it was providing this kind of support that we don't tend to think like that when we think of doing charity, quote unquote. It's always associated with raising money or donations. And I just thought that was really interesting that there's so many other ways to lend support and make a difference. So I actually want to sort of, you know, I want to ask you, and Saransh, you know, you've got like 500,000 followers on Instagram. I want to ask you something, which I've often seen these debates online as well, about what your take is on the idea of speaking about what you've done post doing it, you know. So should we be doing charity silently or share it with everyone? Should we be modest or should we be kind of, you know, it's good PR if you're encouraging others by talking about it? Like, what's your take on this?
I think, Ori, it's an amazing question because it's an answer that I have been looking for as well, especially in this lockdown. Because practically speaking, you know, charity is sort of self-serving in many ways because you want also to be able to be self-satisfied and saying that you added back to the community. I think that truly selfless charity for me is going to come to me after a few years, or I don't know if it exists. But having said that, you know, when I started COVID Meals for India, first I had no idea that it's going to become such a large initiative. And I did not even think that it's going to garner so much PR for me. In fact, one of my friends, my best friend from Delhi, complimented me saying that you have probably received a lifetime worth of PR by doing this. And I did not know how to react to it. Because while he was saying that, my heart was also breaking inside, thinking that my own friend thinks that I did this for probably marketing or PR. For it's fair because, you know, we are looked upon as engines of marketing because social media as a profile is a marketing tool.
Right.
And it is okay for somebody to think that. So while I didn't get angry with him, I actually, one of my other friends suggested that I should go for therapy because she saw me juggling with this thought of the fact that you did something good for your community and you are still battling with the thought in your head, thinking that, did I do this for myself or did I do this to actually help people? I think it's a very troubling one. And I think nobody should be allowed to take that gesture of goodwill away from you is at least the conclusion that I am tilting towards, which means that I used to ask my girlfriend Divya before sharing a PR article on my stories. In the first 2 or 3 weeks of COVID Meals for India, I did not share a single PR article because I was so conscious about the fact that I don't want somebody to think that this is a PR activity because it is not. Mm. As in, deep down, I know that already. But the fear of people interpreting it differently, because if my friend can, I'm sure my followers can. And I'm sure anybody else who is watching it can. I have I gave about, what, 30, 35 press or news interviews, etc. 30, 35 odd within a week. And I was like, and I didn't want to say no to them either because it's...
Because you're amplifying your cause as well, right? And the thing is that it's still going on. So I feel like when it's going on, like to amplify it is...
Absolutely.
You know, it's supporting the idea. And of course, there'll always be, you know, detractors who feel like, oh, this was a PR stunt. But at the end of the day, if it's resulting in a...
Helping people out.
Exactly.
So
then, and that's the, you know, that's kind of a side effect or a fallout of what you're doing, then so be it, right? I think that, and that's how I've always viewed it. But I often sort of see this other side of like, oh, well, why are you talking about it? And I think the where it becomes more tricky is when you're doing something which is, it's an ongoing thing and the idea is to reach more people. And the only, you know, the way to do that is to use like your social media platform, press, etc. Then, you know, you're doing it with a very sort of conscious reason, which is that I want to amplify this and I want to reach more people.
So I have another take on this.
Yeah, but the tricky thing is when it's kind of done and you still sort of talk about it, or, you know, I guess that's where, you know, should you be sort of doing it silently or should you be talking about it post-event is where sometimes there's a bit of a dilemma.
Yeah, so I absolutely agree on that. You know, as a entrepreneur who's built a food brand online with probably a similar structure, which meant I was able to use the same social media tools to give birth to a brand that I run. I was able to use technically the same clout and same strategy to, let's say, give birth to COVID Meals for India. And the same PR engine, the same network, everything is the same. Technically, COVID Meals for India is a brand. Yes, which does not do me any personal
profit.
Profit. That is the only difference. Hence, it's an initiative. Now, and hence, what I have realized is if there is PR that's going to come out of it, which there has some, I need to be accepting of it. And I need to take it in my stride because it's also changed people's vision or outlook of me as a person. Which means that I cannot continue to be the person I was before. And hence, I think that is a longer sort of debate. And I also feel like I'm going to evolve as a chef, where my way, the way I look at food also is going to change. And hence, I would like to believe that the way people look at me is also going to change, where they will probably realize, or for anyone, it stands that, you know what, he just wants to do it because it's his thing. And then I think when you do it repeatedly, no one can question you. I think that is where, as you said, to answer your latter part, if COVID Meals for India after a month is irrelevant and I'm still harping about it and not doing anything with it, then it probably is more of a PR tactic versus just actually doing it for people.
So I want to ask something which is kind of flipping this on its head a little bit, which is that a lot of times people feel pressured or guilted into doing this, right? And you see, you see your peers in the industry or whatever, like doing something and you're almost like, oh my God, I need to be doing something too, right? And the interesting thing is, I don't know if you guys saw, I'm sure you all saw Yash's post. This is Yash Panage, guys, from Hunger Inc. and the Bombay Canteen, where he posted that, you know, charity begins at home and you sometimes are not in a state of mind or in a place where you can maybe do something, even though everyone expects it of you because of your, you know, where you are, your position in the business and in industry and in society, whatever. And, you know, I mean, Nesa, do you have any thoughts on this? Like, is this sort of a fair pressure to put on people who are in a position of influence or, you know, have the means maybe to kind of expect it?
I think you only respond to that pressure if you have the ability to. And I really think that people, like exactly like you said, right? Like Yash, most people with big businesses weren't able, which is why this worked. It was sort of a home baker slightly or some amount of establishment. So sure, Royce did it. You know, you guys did it. There were a bunch of like mid-size restaurants or bakeries that did it. But I think if you did, I think a very small handful of like larger bakeries did it. And I completely understand that. I think that if you're not able to, you do have to actually only do this if you're able. Yeah. And for us, I am, you know, I was, and for a lot of other people, they were. So I also think you only respond to that pressure if you're able. Otherwise, you're like, okay, cool. You know, there's no... I can't respond if you can't.
Exactly.
And I think that with a lot of other people where you're able to respond and, you know, if you're feeling that pressure, sure, because you... Great, you know, like go ahead. As if it helps channel, because we all use different motivations, right, to do things. Like either you're like, okay, I'm feeling too guilty to not, or I'm really excited to do this. As long as it's actually achieving something and we're actually able to do something positive, I'm fine with it.
You know, I have to share like my experience. So a few years ago, so we do the Sunday bake sale at the table, Max Street Bread Co. bake sale. And we decided that, so it's every Sunday. And we decided that every one Sunday a month, we would support a different NGO because, you know, there's so many causes that we want to kind of be able to support in some way or the other. So we'll pick a different one every month. And, you know, the idea is that it may not like raise sort of lakhs of rupees, but, you know, there's awareness, there's, you know, creating awareness about it, about the cause, as well as, of course, the financial aspect. So we donate 100% of the proceeds to a different NGO every month. And when we were allowed to resume our bake sale in September last year, when just before restaurants could reopen, but, you know, you could do sort of takeaway, etc. And so we said, okay, we'll start a takeaway format, at least for the bake sale. And I was like, okay, great. Like, you know, this is, let's start our charity bake sale again. And instantly I got feedback from my team that, you know, this isn't really cool because there are enough people within our organization who also need, you know, support. And I was just like, okay, this is not going in the way I intended. And it's actually going to backfire with my team. And we had to kind of, you know, claw back on it at that time. So we said, fine. And then this year again, when, you know, March, April, again, we were in this lockdown situation and, you know, it was financially a lot more burdensome because, you know, we had our entire team back at work and, you know, but we were going into lockdown again. So the restaurant was going to be closed. And there was a lot of financial pressure to meet payroll. And that's what I really struggle with, is that how do you kind of justify doing, you know, for others when you're not, when you're sort of asking your own team to maybe take a pay cut or saying...
You can't, you shouldn't, right? Like, I do believe...
It really is a very difficult situation to be in, you know? And you like, in my head, I was thinking that, you know, if I'm able to support them like 80%, can I not just also support someone who doesn't even have like that 5%, you know? And it was a real struggle for me. And eventually, you know, I think when you presented this great idea, we were just like, look, this is on a small enough scale. It's not going to kind of upset anyone. Let's just do this at least, you know? And, but I think it's a very real thing that people go through. And it's just, you know, I think you have to like be okay with whatever decision you take finally.
Yeah. I think even with what you were asking, what you all were discussing earlier with like the PR thing, I think that again, it's just whatever you're comfortable with doing. Like for me, I've always struggled with sharing PR. I've worked with the music industry most of my life actually. So there's been enough of it here and there. And I have not once been able to do it. Like, it's just not. And even with, so for me, with Pick for India, it was easier. Like, again, I did a few interviews. And to me, I was like, okay, I'm not going to share them because I only want to share bake sales so that it doesn't detract. So I didn't even share people posting I didn't repost anybody. I only posted because I was looking at it from an efficiency point of view. And I also feel that people think you're doing it from the PR point of view. Like, the thing is, it takes so much time. It was all I did for weeks. Like for me personally, because it was just me doing it, that, you know, it is a big investment of time and effort and energy. So, you know, it's fine.
Yeah. And speaking of this sort of investment of time and energy, I mean, Saransh, do you feel that right now we obviously all responded to a really dire situation, right? And a lot of the charitable organizations that are out there that have been there for years that are supporting causes that have nothing to do with COVID have really been crying out saying, guys, we're still here. Our problems still exist. Our issues still need to be amplified and supported. And that coming back to, you know, what I mentioned earlier, that was one of the reasons actually we chose the charity that we did, because It sort of helps to support like children who live on at railway stations, and right now no one was traveling on trains, and so any kind of income that they were getting had also dried up, and so they were like resorting to other ways to support themselves. And that's what really sort of struck me, that firstly there's so much out there that is still going on, are still problems that need to be addressed. But also, I want to ask you, Saransh, what you feel about, as an industry, whether we do enough through the year and not just when a crisis kind of hits us. What do you think?
Honestly, Bari, on this, I would say that this, of course, this COVID situation is slightly unique to our industry, because we are also trapped as an industry within this pandemic, which means it directly affects the business and our employees, and it's difficult to be able to balance out both. You are absolutely in the right, which means that if GBC had to spend a single penny, by that I mean goila butter chicken, it would first go to the employees and their families and not outside, because it's helping your circle and your community first. I do feel like if I had to look at this beyond our own industry, and when a situation like this arises, we definitely don't do enough, because there are still many things that go untouched, like food wastage has always been a large issue, which we've not been able to tackle seamlessly, because that requires a large network distribution, a lot of coordination, especially from catering, banqueting perspective.
There's a health factor as well, and there's like the health and the safety factor of,
correct, food is spoiled or not, for hotels, that's always a big question, a big question mark to answer, that if food leaves from our banquet and it reaches spoiled to a poor person on the street, they will say, "Arey, ye khana taaj se aaya tha." And I think that is where the big challenge really lies, where policies and restrictions or regulations might stop a lot of people from helping out. But I do feel like food is something that we can be more active about as an industry, and we can genuinely help on a grassroots level people, especially in metropolitan cities, whether it's underprivileged people on the railway stations or on the streets. And there are large communities. So, and as we rightly said, like it was Bake for India, sometimes help can be just food. Mm. You don't really have to spare money always to help people out. I think this could be a good way of us learning that sometimes the answer is just food and small, simple resources that you can probably spare from your end, from a costing perspective.
Yeah, absolutely.
I definitely feel that as an industry, we can do more.
So can we expect something more sort of from you? Do you have any, have you been through this exercise? Do you sort of think, has it kind of triggered any ideas that you think, you can now implement and execute?
I was telling Neza about this, that the first initial thought in the first week of starting COVID Meals for India, when we were changing it into a website, was, should we just call it Meals for India and then drive it accordingly? But we realized that this particular list, where home chefs need to connect with patients, is only timely for COVID or for this crisis. Maybe in the future, you don't need to connect them, but yes. There could be a service where restaurateurs could connect with the needy, or where our industry as a whole could connect with people who are in need of daily food or meals or ration. There are many ways of making that happen. And hence, I think this has definitely triggered that thought in my mind, where I feel like I have a platform which can be further used to drive a similar initiative, maybe within the industry, but there is reach. And there are enough people in need of food. So absolutely, already thinking about it, just need to now put thoughts into action again. Hopefully after the second wave, there is no third wave.
That's really amazing. I think that's, probably the silver lining, because we're always trying to look for one, that, that this effort continues and we can continue to support our community. Nesa, what about you? Any sort of afterthoughts from having been through this and done this?
Yeah, I actually definitely think that this, for me, this is doable long term. It's also partly how, you know, I guess, like discussing it, like Bake for India works across, and raising, fundraising is always going to be, you know, needed over different situations. And personally, it also just makes it so much easier, right? Like my investment is my ingredient cost, but I can raise so much more by just putting in that time. And so I do think it would be nice to do it maybe yearly, maybe I have to work out the structure. But perhaps I feel like early December is always would be a great time to do this, where, yeah, you know, you just get people in, everyone's buying dessert anyway. It's such a win for like a consumer.
Yeah.
I also think it might be really good to just like raise awareness over different sorts of NGOs and people doing work. So I want to sort of like work that out and see, like, now I'll have the time to sort of work out what's possible. I'm still very slowly counting receipts. and we're over 25 lakhs now. So
if amazing.
Yeah.
Well done. Amazing.
So yeah. It's just such an amazing collective. Oh, by the way, Saransh, there's a baker from Chennai who did both did the meals and did Bake for India.
What's their name? Let's give them a shout out.
Anita Jasani. I think her baking thing was called Monkey Temptations.
So, wow. Yeah.
But she has like a bunch
thank
of
you, Nita, like,
yeah, thank you, Nita. That is incredible.
So yeah, I also think that really, I mean, the amount of like positive, again, you know, when you talk about sharing stuff, right? Like sharing things that were happening, I think that we also needed at that point positive news, and this just felt positive. Like I could buy, like, you know, like hearing about the amount of like home chefs joining just felt so positive, right? It makes you feel good. 400 cities, it makes you feel good.
Yeah.
Like, you know, hearing about, like for us, like there was a 8-year-old baker, you know, there was a 12-year-old baker. A 12-year-old raised over a lakh and a half.
Wow. It's amazing. And this is, amazing, you know, I mean, it's unfortunate circumstances, but it's a great lesson for kids. And it's, it's a great
sort of... And even for me, like, personally for me, one day I was rude. Like, I went through, like, of course, I channeled all my anger into action for a while. And then maybe 10 days later, I wept for 3 days straight. And I remember feeling so low one day. And one of these moms messaged me, and she's like, oh, you know, she had finished her bake sale and raised, I think, over 50K. And she's like, my 6-year-old, if I'm not mistaken, wants to make this. And she can only make this lemon cake, and she's going to make this lemon cake. So can she do it? I was like, yes, please. And oh, thank you. So all of that really helped channel, I think, positive movement for everybody else, right? And if you were sitting at home, you could, even if you didn't eat dessert, enough people were just sending something, because everybody needed some amount of something positive, because it was... It still is heartbreaking.
Yeah.
Yeah.
No, but listen, you know, I wanna kind of end on this positive note, because you're both, you know, thank you so much for doing what you did and inspiring everyone around you, because it's so incredible. And again, I just want to sort of reiterate that it's possible to do something without having to, you know, feel this pressure to raise bundles and bundles of money. There's so many ways that we can give back in terms of our time and, you know, just resources and our platform. And again, I want to say a big thank you to both of you all for triggering this, and of course for making time to be here today. And and I'm really looking forward to sort of keeping this momentum going that's obviously started, and continuing to contribute to our community. So thank you again.
Thank you.
Thank you, Gauri. Really kind words. What I'm looking forward is to visiting your restaurants.
Very soon. Fingers, toes, and everything around me crossed. So yes, it will happen. It will happen. But good luck and stay safe, guys.
Thank you. You too.
Bye.
Charity indeed begins at home. But today, I'd like to add an addendum to that. Charity also goes beyond just fundraising and donations. It can be anything from using your platform to raise awareness, to being an intermediary like Saransh and Nisa were, to providing employment to differently abled individuals, to help them become earning members of their family, and so much more. The point is, it's always possible to do something. And this is what being part of a community is about. I hope you feel inspired by our episode today, and I would love to hear your thoughts on this. I hope you enjoyed tuning in today. Do catch the earlier episodes when you get a chance. And more importantly, I would love to hear from you with your thoughts on the show. You can find me on Instagram at Gauri Devideyal or on Twitter at Gauri Details or LinkedIn. Either way, sit back and relax, because this round is on me.
I hope you enjoyed that show. If you aren't following us on social media, please do. We're IVM Podcasts on Twitter, Facebook, and Instagram. We'd like to thank the sponsors on the network this week, Siet and Cred. We really appreciate the support. It is what makes this possible. So it was a fun week on Cyrus Says. We had guests like Dolly Singh, we had Guneet Monga, we had Kamya Jani of Curry Tales, and Cock and Bull, as we always did. Do check it out. I think you'll really, really enjoy that. On Paisa Vaisa, we crossed 300 episodes, and Anupam was joined by Akhil Handa, the digital head of Bank of Baroda. All things policy, discussed topics like the 100 years of China's Communist Party, the Facebook versus the Government of India case, and the evolution of Indian science. On The Wire Talk, Siddharth Bhatia was joined by Gautam Bhatia to discuss the Central Vista project and why it's attracting so much flack. Sadaf and Archit are back on the Naan Curry podcast, and this time they raise the temperatures as they discuss the beloved spice mirchi. On The Millennial Athlete, this week Tanvi and Shlok speak to Sarita Chauri, a visually impaired judoist. And finally, I want to ask you all to give a listen to the Triangle Offense. Anybody who has heard me talk on a podcast knows I can't shut up about basketball, and these guys know more about it than I do. So if you enjoy basketball, do check this out. Nishant and Monish do an excellent job with this show. I was one of their guests a few months ago, which is how I met them and tried to convince them to come onto the network, and they're finally here. So definitely do check this out. Show's available on all major podcasting platforms, but they also have a daily YouTube episode, which is available on the IVM Podcast channel. And with that, I hope to see you again next week.
Do you know Tamil? Tamil Puriyuma? Do your children enjoy great stories that inculcate good values? Hi, I am Ravishankar Balachandran and I host the Storytime Tamil podcast. I am excited to share a short story with great moral values every day. Listen to Storytime Tamil on the IVM podcast app, YouTube, or wherever you get your podcasts from.